thank you, everyone. I think we can agree that this morning's session was really fascinating and interesting and very stimulating. We have heard a lot about China and India this morning, and this afternoon we're going to hear a bit about South Africa and Russia. No, we're going to hear about Russia and South Africa, although from Brazilian colleagues. So there are going to be three presentations, and they are going to. There is a slight change to the program. They are ISAC will not be presenting comments, but will be doing a Russia case study instead. The speakers will have about half an hour each, and I'll monitor the time and tell them. So you've got. Let's make that 20 minutes each to leave some time for questions. Yeah. Okay. So the first speaker will be Elizabeth Balbach-Skevsky from the University of São Paulo, Brazil, and she will be providing a general overview for the session.
I'm going to talk about, in general, stakeholders in higher education policies and a bit more about the BRIC perspectives. What we learn about stakeholders in higher education policies. What's happened? Ah, it's here. So first of all, stakeholders is a concept that was developed in the administration science, organization science. The grandfather of this concept is Freeman. And for him, stakeholder is any group or individual who can affect or is affected by the achievements of the organization's objectives. In the administrative science, stakeholder analysis is important first because it predicts it's a good source for you to predict the organizational behavior. It is also an asset for the organization because it creates a flux of information for any organization to organize and to predict the organization behavior. And it's also a moral constraint in the sense that the real significant stakeholders in one organization for one organization can create moral constraints for the organization's planning. But this is in general. What about higher education stakeholders analysis in higher education studies? First of all, the first time that someone started to wonder about how higher education as a system was coordinated was Burton Clark in the 1980s. Burton Clark proposed the well-known triangle of coordination. I'm sorry it's in Portuguese, but anyway, you have some systems that are coordinated by the state, like we saw today. Some systems that are coordinated by what Clarke called the academic oligarchy, and then some systems that are coordinated by market, by mutual adjustment between different institutions. But also in Clark, there is this idea that university is a kind of matrix organization, in the sense that there is a very important external control that is more sometimes it's out of our view, which is the peer communities of science, a university. You cannot understand how a university works if you lose, from your perspective, the connections that the academic community inside the university is connected with its peers, this is a very important source of constraints for the university. This is very important. And then you have, from this external control, but it's not a direct control, it's indirect control, because it works through the academic community inside the university. Many of the decisions, many of the initiatives from this academic community is organized around this, the values, the propositions, the values that the academic community in the country in general and the, around the world poses. So, for instance, if you say, well, a doctoral thesis must have an original idea, this is not, it's not written in any kind of regulation. It's something that we create as a kind of constraint over our students, because this is some is an expectation coming from the from our peers. So I also would like to point this idea coming from Polanyi, which is this kind of professional power creates a kind of coordination by mutual adjustment of independent academics, initiatives, scientists, and things like that. And then you have also the traditional control of the state. The state always had some saying about how higher education institutions worked, mostly the universities. There were never such a thing like an autonomous university. The university always, in some way or other way, had some kind of constraint coming from the government. In some place, in some countries, the government control the number of academic positions inside the university. In other countries, the state control the way you fill these positions. What are the kind of procedures you have to have in order to fill these positions? In some countries, the state control the budget and things like that. And in 1990s, we have a lot of reforms, not really in the BRIC countries, but mostly in Europe and the United States, but mostly in Europe, that changed this traditional environment that was described by Clark in his well-known work. First of all, in this new environment, you have the presence of external stakeholders in the policy network that deals with higher education policies. And then you have a new role of the boards in all universities. It's very difficult for us in Brazil to understand the role of this board, of these boards inside the universities, because the, the Brazilian universities, we don't have this figure, this institutional figure. We don't have boards with representation of external stakeholders in the governance of the university. But in many countries, we have these boards, and these boards became a place where many universities negotiate their goals, their objectives with the external stakeholders. So it was in after these reforms that the issue about stakeholders became important for for higher education studies. At that time, the people started to realize that stakeholders are really, first of all, a very important source of legitimacy to higher education institutions, and also a kind of relevant moral constraint over the academic objectives inside higher education. I am from the University of São Paulo. I think that most of my colleagues in Brazil know about the crisis, the financial crisis we went through in the last year at USP. And I would say that if we could have some kind of more clear representation of the stakeholders in São Paulo society, maybe we could avoid this crisis that was carved by us. We by ourselves created this crisis for us. So, what we could say about the pre-BRIC experience? I would be very rough in my generalizations, because of course each of our countries are very complex, have very complex systems of higher education. But anyway, I would say that first of all, I think all the countries in our study have in common a kind of segmented profile of the academic profession. Let's say that we could organize the academic world considering two dimensions. First of all is the prestige an academic have among his or her peers. And the other thing is the prestige, the position that the academic play inside the university. What is her position in the academic ladder inside the institution? So let's say in the case of mature systems, most of the academics are in this axis. You have young academics with low prestige among the peers because they are starting their academic career, and also they are in a low position inside their institutions. As they grow, they become more confident in their work as academic, and they grow in their prestige in their community. They also tend to grow, or let's say that this is what we use it to expect, that they would grow in the institutional hierarchy. In this sense, you have more or less a kind of, you will have academics in these two cells. In the case of all BRIC countries, and I would say that in all developing countries, you have academics in all cells. You have young academics, or not so young academics, but people that are blocked in their institutional career, but have high prestige among its peers. And then you have, the elite academic, you know, the academics that have high prestige among their peers, and also are in a high position in the institutional hierarchy. But you also have this kind of guy here that has very low prestige, are almost unknown by its peers, his or her peers, but are in a high position inside the institution. This guy, this profile of academic, is highly conservative, because for him or for her, any kind of change in the academic environment means threat for his position, her position. And then you have these guys here that have low institution, for them, that's the expected situation. But you have also these guys that have high prestige among his peers, but are blocked inside the institution. This situation creates a lot of internal tensions inside the universities. Not all the papers in our book address clearly these kind of problems, but we know that this kind of problem happens in all the developing higher education systems in developing countries. We have low academic coordination, in the sense that kind of professional coordination I mentioned before is weak in our country, in our countries. It's not non-existent, but it's weak. There are a lot of other tensions inside the university that, let's say, damp the pressure, the inner pressure for performance inside the university. And in this kind of environment, we have a strong external perception of moral hazard, in the sense that many people from the government, from the society, look at our university and say, "Well, you have a lot of money, but you don't perform well. We are not doing the things that we, the society, want for them." Well, outside this problem, oh, madre de Dios, 5 minutes. Okay, we have this problem of massification, and we have a new issue that are common among us, which is the issue about equity and new roles of university in regional development. Other common factors is, I think, it's the limited role of external stakeholders. I think Tsai mentioned it, and I think that the issue that he raised for the Chinese experience is also in the case of any other BRIC country, in the sense that, yeah, the state tried to fill the empty space left by the lack of the society pressure. We have now local commitment are growing in our country. The industry are almost absent about regarding higher education. We have few channels for the industry leaders to put forward their pressure, and they seems to be not very interested in these issues. We have a diversification of student profile, which creates a lot of new dilemmas for collective action. You know the collective action dilemma from Malcolm Olson that said, well, it's not enough for some people to share some problems, for them to work in order to overcome these problems. They need to have a coordination, and this coordination is not easy. And if you have this diverse student profile, it means that it's very difficult. In some countries, for instance, in the case of Brazil, this empty space is filled by a high politicization and low representative student movement. In other countries, you have a low degree of mobilization, like, for instance, in India. We have dilemmas associated with the mobilization of the students' families. They have needs, but they don't know how to coordinate their demands in order to create a working pressure over the higher education system. And in all countries, in all BRIC countries, the central government have also a central role as a main coordination pole of higher education systems in Brazil. And we have also resistance from traditional universities and academics. The main differences is the degree of controversy in societies regarding the impacts of a higher education. In the case of South Africa and Brazil, the legacy of democratization and the quest of social inclusion is a relevant issue. In the case of India, the diversity and political cleavages create a lot of pressures over higher education. In the case of Russia and China, we have the state as the main external stakeholders. And we have new roles in the case of China and India of the knowledge society, the relevance of new partnerships with research-intensive enterprises. And as a conclusion, finally, we have the growing centrality of stakeholders analysis for higher education studies. I think it's very important in the case of developing countries, because the absence of a clear attention of what is happening in the stakeholders in society, I think is one of the most important issue for our universities. In the case of the BRIC experience, I think we should take in attention the relevance of the agenda for social inclusion. All countries have this agenda. This is highly important for all countries. It's highly important for the legitimacy of the university, especially the research universities. No university, research university, can thrive in these countries only based on meritocratic arguments. And the law commitment of the economic interest and the law academic coordination. And, well, that's okay, thank you.
Perfect timing, 22 minutes. Okay, next on our agenda is Piliwe Lolwani, Lolwana from South Africa. We will also take 20 odd minutes for her presentation. Thank you.
While waiting for the bioscope to show up. Oh, I wanted to talk to myself. Okay, yeah. I want to kind of preface this discussion by saying that this is a case study showing that higher education is part of a larger society. It doesn't exist in isolation, but also showing how a changing society also has got an influence on the direction in which higher education will change. And therefore, starting by saying that apartheid contributed to a very complex higher education in South Africa. There is no one type of higher education. Where is this? Where is it? Oh, to go? Oh, is
yeah,
this?
No, it's here.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Because the new government inherited a very divided higher education system. In 1996, where we trace the beginning, the new government took over in 1994, and most of the changes started to happen in 1996, where we trace the new government steps. We had 99% participation enrollment rates of Africans, 10% coloreds, 35% of Indians, and 61% white. So you could see that you can see that there was a very low base of African students. And the universities generally were divided and categorized into progressive and non-progressive. Post-apartheid, there had been a lot of clarification in terms of who the stakeholders, both internal and external. A brief theoretical backdrop to this is trying to look at how stakeholder participation is shaped. There are some authors like Gornitska who are saying that it's about the power of the resource dependency, where your power is coming from. Others are looking at the blueprint that in which the universities travel from being elite institution to massifications. Others are looking at some of the things that Elizabeth was talking about, a university as a meritocratic community of scholars, or serving political agendas, or a university as a service to enterprise embedded markets. In South Africa in particular, our higher education system didn't only start its shape and its position during the apartheid, but throughout the colonial history, when there were two universities, one Afrikaans, which is a Dutch descendant language, was established, and an English one. And those more or less formed the templates, the blueprint of what the universities would be like. When the Nationalist Afrikaners took over in 1948, they introduced another version of university where they were going to be building a new institution for each race and ethnic group, in black ethnic group in South Africa. And as apartheid progressed, there was an idea that black people could have their own homelands within the country, and also that brought a need to be able to create further other institutions in these homelands. So we had different kinds of institutions created and established for different things. During the last phase of apartheid, the Afrikaans government introduced another type, which was the technical and vocational higher education institution for the first, that is, industrializing country. But within these different kinds of types of institution, it was clear that there was a rigid social order to which different race groups were being prepared, with the black people being prepared for a subordinated and geographically isolated role. You'll still find even now the historically black institutions are in remote areas and they are teaching some of them, many of them do not have the hard natural sciences, your engineering, your medical studies. So the new government inherited this system, where the desire was that the white population would enjoy a huge advantage, both as institution as well as the products of those institutions, and in higher education and employment, as well as the students. But in all these institutions, there was always state interference, because the state was always trying to make sure that it is in control of what needs to happen. In 1996, the major change came through the National Commission on Higher Education, which was going to reconfigure how higher education system was going to be like. And there were three central principles through which the National Higher Commission was going to be able to deliberate. But we'll focus on the cooperation and partnership between higher education and other social actors, because it speaks to the stakeholder debate. And we have got to be able to look at the society, look at it in South Africa at that time, as well as looking at higher education. At that time in 1996, there was the major policy driver was the reconstruction and development policy, which was a very highly participative policy dimension, where everybody was going to look at how South Africans are going to be included, all South Africans included in South Africa, in terms of housing, of health, of education, of all the public and social demands. But 2 years later, the government changed and withdrew the reconstruction and development policy and introduced another policy, because it realized that it doesn't have the money that it thought it had. The new policy was the growth, employment, and redistribution, which emphasized efficiency. So the university, on the one hand, was geared to be constructing this highly collaborative, highly participative, and including everybody. But the country was now withdrawing and going into a different mode of development. And the first policy that was developed that had a major effect influenced by this the efficiency principles was the size and shape. It now was a withdrawal and from stakeholders being contributing and participating in the development of the policy. But the minister appointed its own statutory body, and when the policy was developed, took it to the public. And the policy was talking a lot about efficiency rules. And it was clear that the government was beginning to centralize the function of the policy instead of being a highly participative system. Meantime, because of all the policies that had been, the direction in which the higher education was going, there were some groupings even inside the institutions called institutional forums, which were established through the Higher Education Act, which meant, therefore, the unions, all the workers would come together and decide on the direction of their own institution. On the other hand, we have had a tradition of new councils, the boards, the external boards that Elizabeth was talking about. But these new councils were being reconstructed in order for them to be more representative so that they are not only speak to the academia and bring a number of people. But at the same time, the institutions were changing because of the efficiency measures that have been introduced by the larger government as well as the department. So there was a lot of managerialism that was growing on with the institution. So you can see the kind of contradictions and tensions that were happening. Even though there was this unwritten pact between government, institution, and society about a cooperative and participative governance system, the policies outside were dictating that the universities must change. And the different universities changed differently. The African-speaking institutions, which have got a tradition of a centralized notion, the English-speaking, which have got a much more a collegial, a very committee-driven process, and the black institutions, which were basically very low-based in all kinds of skills, responded very differently to the kind of changes that were happening. But the main effect was that the managerialism was introducing a new kind of leadership, where it depended on who the vice chancellor was of the university. At the same time, the universities, the participation rates were changing. If you remember what it was like before in 1996, and you can see the trends that there was a growing trend, especially the African students, their participation rate was growing. Again, if you take another slice from 2000 to 2010, it's second last. In 2013, we've had another white paper that is not only looking at the university system, it's looking at the post-school system, which includes colleges and universities. It calls for a higher, a post-school system that is differentiated. And the question that we have got to ask now, after we have seen all these kind of changes, who is going to drive this agenda? Because the higher education system, university system in particular, are looking at the non-university system to be able to expand, to be able to produce differentiation. The internal stakeholders in the universities themselves are not going to be able to drive the kind of change that is required. The government is the external stakeholder and a resource owner, and it will have to steer this sector. The civil society has not been organized in the new agenda. It was organized when it was about expansion, about admission of black students, about social inclusion. But at this point, the concept of representative democracy has to be invigorated in some other ways. And the question that I'm asking, therefore, it is still very hard to understand which stakeholders are going to be able to take the university sector in South Africa in the direction that it has got to go. Therefore, what I was trying to say here is to be able to look through the context of policy developments in South Africa, inside and outside the university, and how and when the idea of a participatory and cooperative governance was mooted. Then looking at what was changing outside that made the university to change in a different direction. At this particular point, we know that the major need is to massify the system because we've got just too many young people who are coming out of the schooling system who have got nowhere to go. But the question we have got to be able to ask is who is going to grow that? Which kind of stakeholders are going to play a major role in influencing the direction of our higher education? Thank you.
Thank you very much. You saved five minutes for further questions at the end. So our next presentation is by Isaac Fruman.
Presents a unique, not because it's very good, no doubts, but unique institution because it's one of the youngest Russian universities that was created after the collapse of Soviet Union. And we had a lot of new private institutions and very small number of new public institutions at that time. So we experienced in our own, in the history of our own university, the process of changes, the expansion and modernization. I would probably rather call it radical transformation of higher education in Russia. And in fact, I'm very happy that our case is presented during the stakeholders, along with stakeholders' presentation, because in fact, the history of the recent development in Russia, China, South Africa is really about changing stakeholders. I will explain later on why I think that this is probably the key point of the story. I would speak a bit about the Soviet system, because you've heard already about desovietization, but probably we need to restore the context. And then I will describe briefly the modalities of expansion and modernization of the higher education as a whole. The Soviet system could be characterized by famous quotation of the founder of the Soviet state, Vladimir Lenin, who said that USSR economic and social system should be considered as one single united factory. The state is the stakeholder. There are no other stakeholders in the picture. And higher education in this system is the part of the factory, of this single factory. And this part is responsible for manpower production. We even invented a new, we thought how to describe this kind of the system, and we called it quasi-corporate. We know what is corporate university. Corporate university is a university attached to the corporation. But if the whole country is one corporation, is one factory, the higher education system is becoming of very similar nature. So we call it quasi-corporate system. And the main features of this system is separation of research. In fact, it's a fascinating story how the Soviet government took research laboratories out of universities after the revolution in 1920s. Very important feature of such system is planned enrollment, planned and limited enrollment. There is no private provision, so the government can control the enrollment quite effectively. And what is and the probably cornerstone of the whole system is mandatory job placement. Because if you produce, if you have a state order to produce X number of medical doctors, you have to place it somewhere. So there was no discourse of employability. Employability was by default part of the system. And probably another illustration of this quasi-corporate system is that even part-time education was specially organized, and it was accessible only for those who work in this sector of the economy. In fact, this, I guess, frankly speaking, that it sounds like a perfect machine. The only problem that people do not like to be part of the machine, but that's probably was the main problem of the whole Soviet system. The structure of the higher education system was also created along with this main idea. Because of the Russian, because of the size of the country, there were very peculiar space distribution of the higher education system. So in each region, the government put, let's say, teacher training institution, medical training institution, agricultural university. They should be specialized in this model. In this model, the comprehensive university is something marginal. Also, there were Some universities were placed near big production facilities. And what's also very important, and I'm grateful to my Chinese colleague, Canadian colleague who spoke about China, who mentioned that in the Soviet system, the universities are subordinated to different branch ministries. And the key functions of universities were centralized. The curriculum development, job placement, etc. In fact, what's really interesting, when we did our study, we found that the very structure of the Russian system was really set up in early 40s. You see that the number of universities really didn't change much since 1940 till the very end of the Soviet regime, because there was a time when the Soviet plan of industrialization was fulfilled. Then there were some fluctuations in the system. So we have we came to 1991 to this with this machine. And what happened in 1991? Two new stakeholders really came to the scene. Households, families, students themselves, and employers, because private business appeared as well. And the government, indeed at that time, made a radical change. They opened the system to new stakeholders, to new customers. It permitted public institutions, it's one of the rare, by the way, features of higher education system, when public institutions have two flows of students. One who are not paying at all, they receive a higher education for free, but also public institution can have students who pay for their education. And also the government allowed private institutions to flourish, and it's increased the autonomy of universities. Previously centralized system functions were taken were given to universities. In a sense, this slide may sound negative, but I think that it was an important step into the right direction. It had some side effects. So state eventually walked away from the picture. Russian universities probably became the most democratic institution compare any other countries, because university rectors were elected by university senates, and they were not, and the ministry couldn't dismiss them even. There were no governing boards or anything like that. Unfortunately, the market came with growing corruption, because we didn't have an immunity for corruption. And we didn't have a tradition of transparency, because everything was controlled. So as a result of this development, we had huge expansion. And I think that I must introduce one important point that we didn't discuss today yet. And this is why we have this expansion, why people want to go to universities. And in fact, in Russia, we see very good economic reason for that. And this is a rate of return, private rate of return. Unfortunately, I have data only till 2005 at this slide. Now the rate of return for higher education is less than it was 10 years ago. But still, there is real economic rationale for students to try to get into the higher education. And as a result, Russia experienced enormous expansion of the system, enormous. You can see that the enrollment of the cohort of the school graduates in 1991 was 28%. And now it's almost 84. So 84% of school graduates can go to universities. And within the age cohort from 17 to 22, it's grew up to almost 55. As a result of that, by the way, Russia appeared among the countries together with Canada and Japan, I guess, or Korea, as the country with the largest share of people with tertiary education degrees. How it happened in 25 years? Let's look at that. And you see that private institutions, indeed, in numbers, we see the big growth of private institutions from 1991 to 2010. But the growth of the number of the students happened not because of the private institutions mainly, but because of the public institutions opening the doors for those who can pay. And that's very interesting development. And here, again, I'm sorry that the figures here are only till 2006, but they show the dynamic. The pink graph shows publicly funded places in public universities. And you see that this line grows very slow. But the yellow line, which shows the number of students who pay to the public universities, is growing really fast. This expansion was accompanied by, I shouldn't call this slight changes in educational and professional preferences, because we don't know what were the professional and educational preferences in Soviet times, because everything was planned. But when you open the market, you can see the preferences. And we see that compared with 1980, the peak of the Soviet system, in 1997, you see that the share of students in technical training decreased significantly, and share of students in economics and law grew significantly. Another very important feature of the system, and I guess that it's really under-researched topic. And in fact, South Africa, as I understand, also had the growth of the expansion largely because of the expansion of distance education. And you see how the number of students in distance program grew up in the last 2 decades. And again, I think that we just now started a project to study what are these students in distance program, what are the labor market outcomes for them, what are the costs. In fact, it's really surprising me that in the literature, this issue, this part of our system, which is very large now, doesn't receive enough attention. So here you see how this expansion happened. And now I move to the structural changes in the system. And the government, the state, came back to the picture in early 2000, when the public started to complain about low quality, when first international rankings appeared and famous Russian universities didn't show great position in there. So one can say that the state policy was divided in three big directions. First is building the elite sector. Russia came into this business later than China, and in fact experimented with different models, because there was a desire to achieve the results very quickly. And we have at least two attempts when the state spent a lot of money, didn't receive significant results. The second direction is the closing down, reducing the low quality segment. And the last thing is about employability linkages with the industry. Briefly, I briefly describe it. The important thing, and also we kind of not ignore this fact, but not discuss it enough, as I think, that we see real difference in funding of these universities. So you can see that the universities, we call it category A universities, research universities, universities of national importance, you see that their financing grew much faster starting in 2007 than for all other universities. And very briefly, three attempts to build the elite group. Again, I think that it was a temptation to do it very quickly, so the first attempt was to consolidate small universities into something big with the expectation that big is better and big is excellent. It didn't happen. It's called Federal Universities Project. The government tried to put these elite, to be elite universities in all parts of Russia, kind of a legacy of Soviet space, spatial distribution. It didn't work well. We have a better discussion of this project in the book. Then there was a project to create national research universities by stimulating some universities to create, to increase the research agenda. It worked much better, at least for some of these universities, including ours. Again, the government did give money to these universities for research infrastructure, but didn't pay for the research itself. And so in the absence of big foundations in the country, it didn't lead to real outcomes. The new initiative, the so-called Russian Excellence Initiative, was launched in 2012, and it's more focused, better financed, and it starts to produce some results in terms of ranking. Even we can doubt that the ranking is important indicator. I really agree that in first 200 there could be only 200 universities. Still, it shows the differences in impact of different policies. I'm coming to the end of the presentation, and I would like to pose a few questions. First, we found that all this development and the expansion, on the one side, it led to really broadening the access to the higher education in the population. At the same time, if you do more careful analysis and you see the differences in the per capita costs in different kind of institutions, you find that the highest decile of the population receives almost more than twice more money in terms of higher education financing than the low deciles. So even the expansion, even within the expansion, we observe the growing inequality in access to excellent, to high quality education. So this is my first question about the impact of the expansion to inequality. I believe that it's very good. I'm 50 seconds.
Yeah. Okay. 4 or 5 minutes.
Okay, I'm finishing. I'm sure that the access even to weak universities is better than no access to any university. But again, I think that we have to understand the dynamic of inequality within the expansion agenda. The second question is definitely how the new types of students influence the universities. You know, maybe for other BRIC countries, it's not yet a big issue, because you still deal with first 25, maybe 30% of the best prepared school graduates. But when you take 60 or 70% of age cohort to universities, you have to expect that their academic preparedness really varies. And as one of the university rectors told me, that my professors do not know how to deal with the students who have difficulties in reading. But they are at our universities, in fact. So how the universities respond to that? In fact, some American public universities are doing interesting job. But what they do really internal selection. They have honors program. Does it really help to these students with weak preparation? It's not clear. Again, I think that this internal heterogeneity of students' body is really under-researched. And I'm sure that it will be the issue for the next decade. Again, I mentioned the rate of returns. I guess that we have to look at that. We have to look at the rate of returns of different kinds of universities. Why students go to business program? Because they know that there is a one chance from 100 to become very rich. There are five chances from 50 maybe if you go to technical training to become moderately rich, but they want to go to business training. So I guess that we have to study it more careful. The next point for further discussion, I think again, and Simon mentioned it today, and our colleague from Peking University mentioned that the economic relevance of higher education doesn't explain the expansion. It doesn't explain what's going on with the students. And Simon used the expression social relevance. I like it, but I think that we have to discuss what it means. I feel that it's really something around the important issue, but I think that we have to clarify what it means. Maybe, and this is my final point, we have to think about in terms of the social relevance to about the third, and some specialists talking about fourth mission. The third mission is, you know, it's community outreach, expansion of knowledge, etc. Fourth mission is development, economic development by universities. Like some Chinese universities did for their provinces and cities. So I guess that the expansion, the rapid expansion of higher education in our countries really poses new questions for the higher education researchers. Thank you very much.
To all three of the speakers, I think there's plenty to discuss. So floor's open for questions, and we can maybe take a couple of questions at a time, and then revert to the speakers.
Well, I think about Russia. I mean, I have one question, which is the question of unemployment, which was raised about India and about China. In case of Brazil, if you have a higher education degree, your chances of being employed is very low. One of the advantages of having one of the stimulus for having a higher education degree in Brazil is that you get it's very likely that you'll get a job, and you can have a well-paid job and a stable job, even if the quality of education is very bad. So, and it seems this is not to be the case in China, in India, and it seems to be a problem in China. And I wonder how this is in Russia, when you break this kind of factory system you had in the past, what happened with that? The other point which I'm curious about Russia is how, if there is any policy related with the nationalities, the different nationalities, different cultures, because this issue, again, is a very central issue in South Africa with apartheid. It is very important in India. In China, is very central. In Brazil, you have the whole issue, the debate about the affirmative action. But I have never heard this about this issue in Russia. So I wonder if this is a something which you've been discussed, or there is any policy related to that. And well, the question of social relevance, I think it will be interesting to discuss. Of course, one of the ideas is that higher education provides social mobility, and in that sense, that's one of the explanations why people get into higher education. They expect that they will move up in different ways. And of course, there is a whole issue which we are not discussing here, but I think it's very central, is the whole issue of the links between universities and the regions. Of course, you have regional universities, or both in India and China and Russia. Brazil, we have much less of that, of institutions which are supposedly run by or linked with the regions. In Brazil, our main region in terms of universities is São Paulo, but they think that they are national universities. They don't think that they are state universities or local universities. So this question of how you link institutions with the region, I think, has to do with this kind of relevance, if they play a role in developing the region, providing services, et cetera, et cetera. So these are my issues, my questions. Thank you.
I was interested to see the progress of distance education in Russia. Really, this has been really expanding, and now it is overtaking the higher education system. I noted there are enrollment 3.5 million as related to 3 million in the system itself. While this really alleviates pressure on the government, however, what about the quality of the education? Are you really making an equivalency between the degrees of those? So I would like very much to illustrate, because this is one of the issues that many countries, including Egypt, are facing. And there was a big debate about questioning the quality and even to cancel the open education. And that is something, it's a big, one of the dilemmas that we are facing with. And the decision we had to make is to focus on specific areas in there with quite a bit of scrutiny on the quality. And the second issue about this, the initiative that has been recently launched. I read about this Russian trying to focus the resources into a number of universities to become one of the first 100 or 500. Again, my question in the previous session about horizontal and vertical expansion, where does this leave the rest of the universities in the horizontal spreads?
Usual thing, when someone speaks the last, he or she receives most of the questions. So I would, by the way, I would ask my colleague from South Africa to join me in answering the question on distance education. And I start with that because it's simple, in a sense. A week ago, I've got a phone call from my colleague, vice rector of our university. He said, "Did you hear that the minister decided to close down all distance education because of its low quality?" And I said, "Well, good luck, because you cannot close down the system with 3 million people. There are problems with that, and the distance education is mainly paid by people. So again, as I told, it's under-researched, and we need to understand it better. There are, that there are hopes that massive courses online provision will help with the quality, It's not clear. I think that it's under research. What do you think?
I will also ask my fellow South African colleagues. But my understanding is that the South African higher education has not been increased by distance education. This is the person who has been working with the numbers of the system, Katie.
It's just about a fifth of that.
So in South Africa, it's one fifth.
There's a mic over there.
It's just about a fifth of the higher education system is by distance.
I see.
And there's been quite strict controls placed on contact institutions that have been venturing into distance because of quality issues. But one of the biggest constraints that have been identified is that the time taken to produce a graduate in a distance education system is not just double the time. So for a three-year degree, it's not just 6 years, it's almost 8 years. And so the return on investment for the to the country is not something that has been explored as an avenue for expansion of access.
Okay, thank you. Okay, it shows again that it should be researched. And briefly, I answer other questions. On unemployment, Russia has very bad graduates monitoring system. The recently the Minister of Education tried to see what happens with the graduates, and the figures are very good. So the majority of the students are on the jobs of the graduates, but there is a big discussion about the relevance of their jobs, first to the type of the training they receive, and the second to the level of the training they receive. So do they work on the jobs that require higher education? In fact, even in our university, we have discussions on that. I personally think that it's okay if they have a job that doesn't require higher education, they probably do it better. But there are discussions on that. Do you have any figures on that? The employment of, I guess it's, the unemployment is very low, right? Of the graduates. Okay, so the unemployment of higher education graduates is below 2%, so it's not a problem. On ethnic issue, it's very interesting, Simon, that you ask that. We really don't have it in our discourse now. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, that had really 15 subsystems. Russia is very much uniform, Russian higher education system. And even Bolsheviks invented massive affirmative actions in after the socialist revolution. Now Russia doesn't have really affirmative action program. We just discussed with Professor Kuzminov that maybe we have to come back to this issue, especially in the light of the inequality by income. And on the gap between excellent so-called world-class universities or to be excellent universities and other universities, it's a problem. It's unfortunately, when you have limited resources, you have to make difficult choices. And Russian government made this choice, and other universities. So the gap between universities, between this group and the majority of universities, is growing. And we don't understand yet what will be long-term consequences of this development. And the very last thing mentioned by Simon on federal regional things, I guess that, again, it's under-researched question. Russia is the country with extreme centralized higher education system. Among almost 550 public universities, only 13, or maybe 12 now, belong to the regional authorities. All others under the central command. And we argue that maybe, like China, the government has to devolve it to the regions, but it's not going to happen soon. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any last comments on any of those issues comparatively? Okay, well, let's move on to please, Michael.
Michael, from the University of Johannesburg. I have a question for Russia. It appears like some of the changes in the Soviet Union were driven by profound political and ideological reasons. In terms of changes, what does it mean in terms of the content of the of what's happening at the university level? Are there any major changes in terms of the content, not just in terms of expansion? I have also a question for yes. You seem to be arguing that the stakeholder influence seems to constrain the university. Out of the study, what's the way out? What seems to be a way out of this? Like the university chained by the stakeholders. So is there any way out?
Okay. Yes, and then you next. No, here, it's going round, sorry. I am sticking to the order, sorry. Okay. There we go.
Thank you very much. I'm Deborah Fogel from Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. And in fact, part of my question was already tackled by Professor Isaac, but I would like to hear a little bit about the opinion, mainly by my colleague, Professor Elizabeth, about fostering and world-class university in BRICS and mainly in Brazil. I would like to hear opinion of everyone from the panelists about constructing. Are we at the time to spend money on these or not? And Dr. Isaac already mentioned a little bit about, but I would like to hear other opinions, and mainly in Brazil that we are far away from even start a discussion, a serious discussion on fostering world-class universities in countries. So I would just like to hear opinions.
Okay, thank you.
My comment and question is also for Professor Froman. The first part is quite frivolous, so you don't have to respond if you don't want to. I was just wondering why you had the Bolshevik hammer and sickle signia for enterprises.
Would you explain?
For business, you had the... In this, you had... For business. That's quite a turn up for the books. The more serious one is about rate of return. I'm not sure that your numbers are correct when you mention 110 to 160. Aren't you talking about 11 to 16% on the private rates of return? But the question I want to make is that in a context of limited government resources for higher education, should you not be looking at the social rate of return in higher education rather than private rates of return, which would indicate how important higher education is for development of society rather than the development of individuals?
Okay, since we're here, we can take one more, and then we'll have a response, and then another round.
I have doubt with regard to the unemployment rate data that your colleagues are coming out with, you know, with reference to higher education. Because even in developed countries, you know, it's hovering around 3%. And what I read, you know, for 2 years back for Russia, it was 4.6, something like that, overall. So if it overall, if it was 4.6, then I'm sure for higher education, it must have been around 9-10%, you know, because as of the date for Japan, it is 12%. For most of the developed countries, it's around 9-10% unemployment rate. So I doubt, you know, for Russia, it could be less than 2%.
Okay, I think let's stop there now and have some responses, and then we have another round.
Working now. So first of all, there was a question about how the stakeholders as a constraint over the universities. Well, I think that this constraint, it happens because stakeholders can be an input for decision-making process inside the university. They also put some moral constraints over the university, but this kind of constraint should not be perceived as a bad thing. It's something good because it creates some kind of directions from external sources that it's very important for the higher education institutions. I think that this is something that it's really we don't have in the case of Brazilian universities, because I don't agree with Professor Froman. Our universities are the most democratic ones because our rectors are elected by students, employees, and academics. And in some universities, it's one person, one vote. So it's the university only works on the internal stakeholders, and this make a very dysfunctional university. In this sense, that was the idea of Friedman, is that taking care about the external stakeholders create a kind of balance over this kind of internal dynamic inside the institution. So I think that yes, it creates constraints, but these constraints are not a bad thing for the institution. On the contrary, it expands legitimacy and create a kind of a more balanced decision-making process inside the institution. The other thing was our issue about research university policies in Brazil. I think that we have this policy in place, but we do that in a very peculiar form because we don't want to face this discussion. What we concentrate is the resource for research. So in the last few years, our research budget have been concentrated into very large programs like the ENCT, the Institutes for National Technology and Research and things like that, Institutes of Millennium and things like that. And these processes create a lot of concentration of research capabilities in our university. In our research in 2007 with the academic profession in Brazil, we found out that, well, okay, almost 60, more or less, percent of our academics, they say that research are their most willful, most important role. But most of them don't have money to do research. Our students, our doctoral students that go to the private sector, they don't have access. They don't have not even citizenship to ask for money to continue their training, because they were training to be researchers. And when they go to the private sector, they don't have the possibility to ask for support from public money. So I think that yes. On contrary of what we usually say, Brazil has a policy for creating research university. The only problem is that since we don't face this issue, we create a very unbalanced institutional framework for these research groups, because the research groups, they receive the money and then the funds and they don't have real institutional support to stay on work for a longer time. That's, I think that is our main problem.
Yeah, I will also have a comment on the research in university as well as the world-class university. I think if you're looking at the point of view of internal and external stakeholders, the agenda of a research university is very important to the internal stakeholders. It is important for universities to be able to produce knowledge because that is how institutions are able to contribute to society for innovation. But it's a limited agenda because there are also other stakeholders who demand and require certain things. A university cannot be there for the purpose of being developing itself for a world-class status. Public universities are paid by each and everybody's tax money, and therefore they have got to have a high agenda of serving a social agenda. There is a growing political agenda, especially in developing countries, of young people who are not anywhere. They get out of the schooling system. As much as we expand our public schooling system, they have got nowhere to be able to transition to. We are disenfranchising our young people in terms of their citizenship by having the haves and have-nots in terms of university education. So whilst the agenda of world competitiveness and the highest class agenda is important, it must be seen in the light of both the internal and external stakeholders. Who is it important for?
In fact, first probably I will answer Professor Spilai question why I use the Bolshevik symbol for employers. It was, frankly speaking, a joke. We discussed it. Another idea was to show the dollar.
Chelsea football club.
Yeah, or Chelsea football club. That's a good, I like it. On the content of post-socialist transition, that's another issue that probably deserves a special study. What happens in radical what happens with university curriculum after radical social transformations? We discussed it recently with a colleague who is studying the changes of Portuguese university curriculum after Salazar, after ends of Salazar regime. And we didn't research it well. We know that the ideological part of the curriculum was removed from the curriculum completely. The rest is professional and it stays like it used to be. The question on social rate of return, I agree with Professor Pillai that we need to look at the social rate of return. You know, again, that's under-researched question. When we started to study that, we didn't have enough data. This is our ongoing project right now. Thanks. It looks like I answered all questions. Yes.
You don't want to answer on why stakeholders are holding South African universities to ransom at the moment. No. No, I don't want to try. Okay, we've probably got time for one more round if we want to ask some more questions. Anyone want to volunteer? There's one. Any more?
Yes, thank you for coming, all of you. Coming here, I am Elvira Carvajal from the State University of Rio de Janeiro. Since we are all interested in stakeholders in universities, I would like to know if you have data on how would be this rate of returns to which stakeholders? to which stakeholders are we talking about? It is, you know, for a student, for job, for industry, development, level of education, impact in development. So I would like if to all the panelists, if you would please comment on this.
Are there any more questions? One more at the front here.
It's just not one comment on the issue of if the 2% of unemployment in Russia is too low. I mean, in Brazil, I think it's more or less like that either. So the way of measuring unemployment sometimes is different from country to country. But at least for in our case in Brazil, now we're getting a little more in unemployment. But until last year, Brazil was having something like 6 or 7% of unemployment rate. And this was higher among poor people, but it was quite low for people with higher education. So 2%, as he mentioned, it's quite reasonable, at least comparing with Brazil.
Okay.
No, so India, if you look at the case of India,
it's very different, yeah.
Unemployment rate is 28%, despite that the private rate of returns of the higher education is roughly 13%. So, probably, you know, you can't make it.
Yes, I'd rather use the microphone.
They're having a little argument in the front here. Let's hear.
I was talking about the unemployment rate in India, which is roughly 28% for graduates and above. You know, the overall is 3.4%. But when you try to look at the private rate of returns for the higher education, it's still around 13%. You know, so probably it's not a common phenomenon that you have a high. It depends on the cost. You know, cost factor is important when you calculate the rate of returns. You know, it's not the unemployed. Why in India when I'm talking? My student pays less than $40 for 2 years for getting a master's degree, you know, then it is obvious the rate of the returns would be higher, you know, 14%. It goes without saying. Fine. The important question is now, how do you look at the social rate of returns, what Pundi was trying to tell us, you know? Where does it stand and to what extent, you know, you get good social returns in higher education, you know? That's another dimension for which we need calculations across different nations, you know, which still, I think, for a couple of countries we have data, but not for all the countries.
Yeah. There is one more question.
Yes, Professor Balmachevsky mentioned that Brazilian universities, they do not have any sort of stakeholders, boards or councils. And that's true. But most of the, or at least all of the university councils has representatives of the community. In my old university, we had 3 representatives of the community in a university council of 52 people. And I think it's symbolic and doesn't help much in terms of the social control. But I'd like you to elaborate more about why that happens, since that most of the reorganization of the Brazilian democracy has built in every sector social councils or conference, national conference, such as in health, education, housing, everywhere. And why did the Brazilian universe did not change it to that direction?
Maybe we could start by answering that question, and then everyone could end off by answering the.
So I think that.
I think that there are 2 questions. First of all, if we could calculate the rate of returns for each of the stakeholders, well, in the case of Brazilian case. If you look at the students, I think that we tend to look at the students as the students of the public universities, but we should think about that 70% of our students attend the private sector, and most of them attend very small, attend, let's say, the for-profit sector. It's not small, very large teaching only institutions. And we'll say, well, what is the social return of these guys that are doing such a lot of effort to attend evening courses and lacking time, good time with family and things like that? I think they have a lot of social returns, especially these people. I think that Professor Renato Pedrosa once made a comparison. We in Brazil, we have an examination at the end and at the beginning. At that time, I think that until, let's say, 3 years ago, it was from the students, the freshmen, and from the people that were ending the program. And he said, well, you, and he compared in engineering education, the students that were attending the best programs and the students that were attending the worst program. And he said, well, you see the students that are finishing the lower quintile of our engineer programs, they are ending that program, learning the things that the students that are attending the best programs start with. But I would say, but at least they are learning something. Because we, in the private sector, they deal with students that cannot even read. And I would say that these students, in many cases, they end the program at least knowing how to read 5 lines. That's much better than having difficulty to read 2 or 3 words. Someone would say, well, but it's a lot of waste of time. I would say, yes, it's a lot of waste of money in terms of society. But for these people, in the case of Brazil, finishing an undergraduate program, having a bachelor program, means a lot, means skills, competences, because most of them are attending business programs. So they have some learning about economics, about accounts. They have some general skills for doing well in a labor market that is mostly service and commerce and, well, service sector. So I think that, yes, for them, I think it's quite good. For the public sector, we should ask about the lot of public money that go into the universities. But I think also that the students have the lot of rate of returns in this experiment, mostly because in the public sector they have access to a network that will improve a lot their employability. This is the most, I think, is the most important role of the public sector in Brazil, is to create a kind of network. And maybe these new affirmative actions could at least improve the diversity in our elite. For the academics, of course, we complain a lot, but I think that we have good terms of employability, even in the private sector, because in the private sector, we had this data. Most of the academics in Brazil are satisfied with their conditions of work. So that they may have some complaints, lack of money for research and things like that, but they are more or less satisfied with their conditions of work. I think that the more important issue is the regional authorities and things like that. I think that the social return of our universities, especially the public universities, are low. It could be much more than it now has. The impact of our university, although it's not irrelevant, it could be better. And the question about board, yes. And to back the rector in the tough decisions he or she is facing when dealing with the internal constituencies. This is something that we don't have in our universities. And I think that this is the most important explanation of our crisis at the University of São Paulo, because we had an increase of 150% of the income of the university, and we run out in a crisis because we expended an increase of almost 200% of our budget. But that happened because it was a very closed community, and well, if you are going to have that, I also want the same to my faculty, to my department, and this kind of tension inside the university don't have another saying from the society. So I think that it's not enough to have the people inside the academic senate some one or two or three, because it's what you say, it's just a symbolic, they don't have real, and they don't feel with legitimacy to have any saying about the things inside the university. But that's it.
Yeah, I want to try and answer the question about which stakeholders. What I was trying to say here is that when stakeholders arise and agitate on an issue, you usually can trace that in the larger society. At the beginning of the new government, onset of the new government, the issue for South Africa was always going to be transformation, because the old society had to be transformed from a segregated society, from a society that has been treated differently by its own government, from social exclusion. So those issues, they were a larger agenda of the whole of South African society. And they found that way, their way, that agenda, into a university setting. So the university setting as an institution also had to agitate against the things that were not right in society. The institutions in South Africa have gone a long way in terms of making interventions that you could say everything is fine. There are many, many black students. In fact, the enrollments in each and every universities are very high on black students. You find a lot of black staff who are on the program. If you look at in the last 20 years of the PhD participation of black students, it has risen almost 700%. And what Professor Banks was asking as to why am I not talking about this stakeholder uprising, there's a new agenda that has surfaced. The universities, again, are up in arms. They're saying there's no transformation. Again, you have to ask yourself, where is this agenda coming from? The society by itself is again rising, the larger society, of saying the Mandela government sold us out. The transformation that it brought about didn't go far enough. That negotiation that was that created the country didn't go enough to be able to get black people where they are supposed to. They still don't have land. They still are employed in lower positions. And what is happening in the universities, black staff are agitating, saying that we are not promoted enough. There is agitation around the language use. There is agitation around symbols, the statues that have been there. But it's a reflection of where society is. So it's difficult to be able to say which stakeholders, because it always mirrors what the mood and of the society, and it goes into the university setting. But it will always be picked up by different stakeholders in different times.
Thank you. Do you want to make a final comment on stakeholders?
I think that the idea to look at the stakeholders' rate of return, not just social rate of return, is very interesting. Indeed, when we talk to different stakeholders, to provincial governments, to local communities, to employers, we have to admit that they have their own interests, and therefore they want, and they have all rights to request us to explain what they get from us. And we see that, do we like it or not, that these discussions more and more focused on tangible and measurable results. Again, I personally don't like it, but that's a brutal reality. And therefore, the whole discussion of stakeholders today is very much about our ability to show what we do. In fact, I was really impressed with the recent changes in the British research assessment exercise, where they increase the weight of the so-called impact factor. Impact, not in citation, but you have to prove that what you do helped to the society, etc. We, unfortunately, especially in Russia, I would say, the public universities took for granted that they play important role for the country. And they have no culture to explain why it's important to have them, to keep their laboratories, to keep courses, et cetera, et cetera. I guess that we have to learn how to do that. And as researchers, we have to study how the most successful university do that. Thank you.
Okay, well, that's just about perfect. We lack on time, on point. Can we give everyone some applause for this session? Thank you very much. It's tea time.